This is Professor Doyle Young again. I hope you're having a very good day. We're on chapter 6, which is a critical topic of leadership and values. As I got to thinking about what to say to you today, I can't help but probably opening my remarks by saying that if you talk any discussion about leadership, really need to talk importantly about the values of the leader. And this is probably the most critical area outside of any discussion about skills of leaders or knowledge of leaders. It is their personal values. And I probably can't state too strongly, it may be personal values of the leader, maybe one of the most important determinants of how a power is exercised or constrained in organizations. Today, as I get older, as I look back on the years I've been in business, over 40 years, and working in organizations at all levels, I can't help but think how important it is for me as a follower, as I think of those days, early days, of having people that I work for that represented values that I thought were common values amongst all of us. And we're going to talk about some of those. And so when you talk about personal values, you can't help but talk about ethical questions about how people use those, how they use power in an organization. One of the largest, most significant trends in the United States today, and I think there's clearly some evidence that this is working worldwide, is what academics are referring to is the area of social responsibility and ethics. That is, are our leaders acting socially responsible? Do they have practices that are reflective of the common good? And are they taking responsibility for those actions and working ethically in those areas? So this is a challenge, it becomes a challenge for leaders as we move, frankly, into a more complex, diverse, and global environment. Leaders are facing dilemmas that require choices between competing sets of values and priorities. I have talked with some leaders who have gone on to prison, and I've had conversations with them when they've gotten out. I've also, during 3 years of my career, I left my executive roles, my teaching roles, and became a chaplain inside prisons in the United States. Some of this was full-time roles where my office was inside, and I did that because I was really drawn to helping people who had been disenfranchised from society. And so I was able to see, frankly, both sides of that. I was able to see those that have gotten out of prison and reflected on what happened to them, as well as those that were that remained inside prison. And when I talk with them, what happens is that invariably the conversation will say, I end up taking a shortcut. And I'm talking here about white collar crime, theft of money, fraud, and so forth. So they, they took these shortcuts and they thought that they wouldn't get caught and they could pay it back. So they, the penalty for those that are caught can be, will be quite substantial here in the United States. Leaders, having said all this, leaders do set a moral example that becomes the model for an entire group or organization. And depending on what level the leader sits within the organization, it can have a significant impact, obviously, the higher you go up in an organization. We've had situations over the last few years in the United States where we've had chief executive officers of companies led to prison in handcuffs. And this is unfortunately becoming more of a common occurrence as the sort of the moral decisions that these people are making are poor decisions, and they are found out. So it's important, and history is really quite clear that leaders should internalize a strong set of ethics, principles of right conduct, or a system of moral values. Good leaders tend to align the values of their followers with those of the organization or movement. So there are qualities of leadership that engender trust, the ability to set vision with people, to be empathetic, that are predictable, consistent, and act with integrity. Integrity, to me, implies that they act with their verbal and their behaviors that they model for others match up with the values of the organization. So those are two are in alignment. And so it's very important that those values that we would define as constructs representing generalized behaviors or states of affairs that are considered by the individual to be important. So that those values, those constructs, if you will, line up with the organization. There are increasingly organizations that post their values of their organization in their plans and on their websites, in their materials. And some of those values can be such things as integrity in our work, trust in teams, honesty in our dealings with people, the raising up of importance for customers, and on and on and on. So these organizations that state their values also need to be as thoughtful about ensuring that they have mechanisms in place to ensure that their executives and leaders are behaving according to those values. Though we recognize that sometimes there are a set of values that with individuals in the same work unit can have considerably different values. And we frankly can only make inferences about people's values based on their behavior, you know, what they say and what they do. There are important relative values in organizations. Figure 6.1 goes into some of those that are values in organizations, what people value. I think probably one of the most important ones is stated in 6.1, which is affiliation. And people really like a value of affiliating with other people. Since we're relational, human beings are highly relational. That's particularly important for people. So that one I would call out. There also is other research, not necessarily part of the text, that would say another key value for individuals is autonomy, the ability to be self-managing, to have the requisite power to do a job and to act out of that power. Another value for people is authority, that is having, along with the responsibility, the power to act in order commensurate with the position. So affiliation, authority, and autonomy are key workplace values that are extremely important, frankly, in all positions. We find too that that values do shift amongst generations. You know, veterans, we recognize in the United States from born between 1922 and 1943 have a particular set, are molded by a distinctive set of experiences that are critical in developmental times, you know, during critical development times. Baby boomers, likewise, from 1942 to 1960, born during that period. Gen Xers are 1960 to 1980, and what we call Nexters are 1980 on. And so we realize in the workplace that that values do, people value things differently. And that's sort of what I would characterize as the fringe of values, and the core values, of course, are the things that we all want, okay? The research has shown that there is little evidence of a generation gap in basic values, the kinds of things that people hold dear to themselves. There are, and it's important to consideration in how one thinks about value-related issues or ethical dilemmas. And my experience has been is that during one's career, one is faced with ethical dilemmas. And those dilemmas can really, frankly, be illegal or amoral. And people that cross over those and make those decisions put themselves and the organization in jeopardy. There is a moral reasoning process, you know, leaders use to make decisions about ethical and unethical behavior. And so there is, with leaders, a manner by which they solve moral problems and move the organization more clearly in a pattern of whether leaders are making these moral judgments that are really important, that set the basis for modeling that with other people. There is a particular chapter, or table 6.2, which talks about key workplace values, and I might just spend a few minutes talking about those. For example, with recognition, leaders with strong recognition values, such as politicians, want to stand out and be the center of attention. They value fame, visibility, and publicity, and are motivated by public recognition and seek jobs where they will be noticed. So one of the key work values is recognition. Another one is power. And you know, leaders with strong power enjoys competition and being seen as influential. And if you go down that list on 6.2, you'll see that there's a whole list of workplace values that frankly attract people to them based on you know, their choices, if they like those particular jobs, or they grow up in those jobs and have come to enjoy the values of that particular position. There are some people on that list call affiliation. Those are leaders with strong affiliation values, such as people in sales positions that find being around and working with others to be highly motivating. So they're highly relational and affiliate with others. if you go further in the chapter, you can take a look at how those organizational values represent the principles by which employees are to get work done and treat other employees. So the values sort of replicate themselves in terms of the collective values of the organization with other people. There's other things I'd like to mention that I happen to mention that I'd like to mention that's not necessarily in the book. And there seems to be a common set of values that I think is worth talking about for leaders that's in research material it's in here, but it hasn't really been brought together in this particular chapter that I think needs to be mentioned. And I want to mention eight of those values that are good gauges of character for the individual and a good way to gauge growth with a leader. And they're actually critical, I think. The first one is we've talked about, which is honesty and fair dealing with people. They tell the truth. If they can't tell the truth, then they pick the time to tell the truth. But they sort of their yeses, they make their yeses yes and their noes no. The second one is integrity, where their values line up with their behaviors. The values of the organization line up with their behaviors. Their personal values line up with the organization. There are sometimes personal values get in conflict with the organizational values. And that puts people in a very difficult situation. And I think a good example, it's not always popular to mention, but during World War II in Nazi Germany, I think there are a lot of people that were co-opted by the German Nazi Party, the Socialist Party there, that co-opted people into a set of values that were not their values. And there was a lot of struggling that went on around that for individuals. The third one is a proper values based on absolute truths. And there's a whole body of thought that says there are absolute truths. And if you look at faith-based organizations, you know, the tenet for many of those says that there's a God who has given his view about what those absolute truths are. And so for many leaders, their behavior is based on absolute truths. Fourth is faith. Faith is a belief in things unseen and unheard, and so people have faith that their employer is going to pay them on a regular basis. They have faith that when they drive their car or ride their bicycle or walk, that you know, they're not going to be hit. You know, we all operate under the belief that there is a faith that things will work out, and we may be stoic, but we're positive, and that we rely on other people to have faith in them. The fifth thing that seems to be evident with a lot of leaders is the area of of humility, which comes out of a heart of service and serving other people. So I've seen this with a lot of leaders where there is a great humility. I've also seen leaders which can be arrogant and dictatorial, and that's frankly a form of leadership. But I find that they attract a greater following with people with a humble spirit. Patience is a great leadership characteristic. Patience is is something that's acquired and it's learned, and it's dealing with people is to deal with them out of a sense of patience. Seventh is discipline. Leaders are the better leaders, I think, are disciplined people. They work. Their workplace values, how they commit themselves to task and getting those done, they follow through on their commitments, and so forth. And lastly, it's the area of self-mastery. They say, there is a saying that all development is self-development, and so leaders, exceptional leaders, go about being self-mastering. They commit themselves to lifelong learning and the acquiring of skills. So, you know, there are positive forms of leadership in which these eight areas, I think, are operating under authentic leadership, which is, you know, sort of grounded in the notion to thyself be true. And there is also with these eight, there's a case to be made of the servant leadership. That is, a leader's role is to serve others. They subject themselves to criticism. There is some criticism with this, for its tendency to suggest that serving others is an end in itself. But that is not necessarily true. I think that there's a whole servant leadership, which is a moral justification for bringing people into a relationship and helping create an environment in organizations where people can do their job. There is also a couple other sections within the book. I'll shift gears here and talk about what is culture. And a culture are those learned behaviors characterizing the total way of life of members within any given society. It's the most salient aspect of any culture typically involves behavior. You know, distinctive actions, mannerisms, and gestures, characteristics of behaviors or characteristics of the culture. And business leaders must become aware and respect of cultural differences and cultural perspectives. We know that we live in a highly diverse world today, especially in cultures that have a lot of diversity. In my life, I've lived in San Francisco and Los Angeles and other parts of the country where you may have 60 or 70 or 80 different cultures from different kinds of cultures, different nationalities in those organizations. So as we grow in our leadership is to recognize that there's a framework for understanding the cultural differences. And it's important to understand those different areas. And the book goes into, I think, an excellent job describing those. It's in the section called Our Framework for Understanding Cultural Differences. You know, source of identity, you know, individual, collective, goals, means of achievement, orientation to authority, response to ambiguity, those kinds of things. Lastly, I like to talk about an area that is really important for leaders, and that's the area of culturally, what I call culturally contingent behaviors. Table 6.6 gives examples of leader behaviors and attributes that are culturally contingent. These are the areas that we need to be aware of within a culturally diverse workforce that are probably more at play in terms of leaders and how they work with different groups and individuals. For example, some cultures can be very ambitious, some can be cautious, some other cultures can be very compassionate, for example, in Tibet. Some cultures can be we can be domineering or individualistic. So leadership, because it's really inherently, as we've talked about, a complex management dilemma because of the demands of the workplace and that are placed on that leader, that the leaders have to be really sensitive, more so than ever, to the culturally diverse nature of the workforce. And this globalization is taking place in the world. And I'll close with telling you a story. Early in my career, I had a startup company, and I was visited by some Japanese who came over from Japan to negotiate with my company on collaborating on a new venture. And I met them at a hotel, and I did not understand how was I ever to coach and how to deal cross-culturally with the Japanese. And I subsequently learned that I totally blew our time together, which they probably found very disrespectful. Not only was it the bow, it was how the card was extended at such an angle, and there was a giving of gifts, in which I did none of those things. So that's a case in point for all of us, is to really understand this cross-cultural communication and how each of us bring our sort of our own culture with us, and how we have to be ever more sensitive to the cultures and the people there out of respect and appreciation. So thank you very much. We'll meet you next lecture.